Well, it's a real pleasure to be here, to still be here, and to still be speaking about Kierkegaard. That's something that probably Kierkegaard would wonder. You know, which one of me is here? It really. I don't exactly know how all of this happened and how I got drawn into Kierkegaard and his world and celebrating the bicentenary. But I was here in September of last year. And I had the great pleasure of going foraging, a wood I really didn't know very much about, with René Redzepi, who had been at the New York Public Library a year before. And it was a magnificent day. I'm telling this a little bit quickly, I promise. It was a magnificent day, though it was raining profusely. And we went into the woods, and René Redzepi had asked me to... I asked him, do I need anything to go foraging? And he said, yes, bring some boots. And I brought boots that were more or less like this. And I remember him laughing, thinking, you know, really, you really don't have a clue. So he gave me big boots, and we went off into the woods, and I discovered what it means to live in the world where plants and herbs grow. And I remember one line more than any. I remember we were standing in something that could come out of The Hobbit. Somewhere, where is that part of
we just went to Amma.
There you go.
You see, This is when you know that it's completely lost in translation. I mean, I know I was somewhere and it felt very special, and now I know it's Amma. I remember there we were.
There are very pretty sights on Amma.
There are very pretty. Yeah. I mean, it was a very special moment to me, not least of all because of the boots I was wearing. But I remember very clearly René saying to me, you know, we were looking at the forest. This was before we went to the ocean, I think. And he said, where you see a landscape, I see a larder. That was very, very, it's made me think a great deal. So, René.
Yes.
Here we are talking about, I think, love, and talking about pleasure, something you know a little bit about, for giving a lot of it to a lot of people who come to NOMA. And I'd like to start today with having you read something you wrote. Mm-hmm. It's called My Favorite Room.
Yeah.
You might want to contextualize it or not at all, but here it is.
Yeah. Well, it says October 2012, although that's when it was published. It was done way before that, so I'd actually completely forgotten about it until you gave it to me. And this is one of the small things that you ask to do all the time as a... for better or worse, a so-called famous chef. And this is, I was asked, where do you have a favorite place in Copenhagen?
Do you know that in The New Yorker, I reread Jane Kramer's piece, and she says that you're the most famous Dane since Hamlet.
We hit it off pretty well.
No, but I think I think it's wonderful that you are compared to a character. Anyway, go ahead.
Excuse my voice. It's not because I've been screaming, but I've actually been sick for 2 days. My favorite room. Copenhagen's Royal Library Garden is, of course, an outdoor space surrounded by buildings, but it's my favorite room. Perhaps I've chosen it because I spend 16 hours a day or more inside NOMA. So it's a relief to have some fresh air. Even though it's smack in the middle of Copenhagen, not too many people know about it, or actually go there. It's a bit secret and hidden. It's one of the most tranquil places in all of Copenhagen, if you ask me. I came across it about 10 years ago. I was working at the time at Kong Hans Keller, which is close by. I was searching for a place where I could think and unwind while sitting on the grass. On any given day in Copenhagen, there'd be masses of Copenhagen occupying every patch of grass. So I wanted to find somewhere where there were no sound or city noises. Suddenly, I found this space in a neighborhood that I had blindly walked by many times, imagining the pathway led to another building. But one day, for some reason, I followed in a spirit of exploration, and all of a sudden this place revealed itself to me. Now I go there all the time, even at night after work, and sit there on the lawn. Sometimes I'm the only person there. There isn't much to do or see. A fountain in the middle of an ornamental pond, some flowers and a lawn. Another thing I like about it is that Kierkegaard used to wander through here. In fact, there's a good statue of him in the garden too. Its origins are fascinating. In the 17th century, it was a shipyard, but it was reclaimed and turned into a square 100 years ago. On one side is the Royal Library, and the other lies Parliament. And there's a lovely old space that used to be the Royal Riding School. Although now, there aren't any horses. It's a place where you can feel history ambling by, but at the same time, you can tune out of city life. I just sit there, think, go through the day in my head. I take my family there all the time, and occasionally friends too. They're always amazed to discover it. The only other people are usually other couples or families. There are no girls in bikinis sunbathing, or boys drinking from a six-pack, or youth playing football with ghetto blasters. No, it's a different kind of place.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You say that you like imagining Kierkegaard wandering through that garden.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's a funny thing with Kierkegaard, because I've lived in Copenhagen all my life.
Since you were 7 years old?
Yeah. Right. Well, we also had a house here.
Right.
So even though I was most of my time in Macedonia, we still had a place to live here. And as a Dane, you sort of feel it as a sort of given thing that you have to study Kierkegaard a little bit. And I've tried. Believe me, I've tried many times to study Kierkegaard, and I just can't, you know? There's always something that blocks me, and I think there's two specific reasons. And those are the reasons why I actually accepted, besides you being a nice guy, to come here. Because I thought it would be nice to come here as the, not anti-Kierkegaard, but just the guy who never got him. And, you know, to me, he lived too much in his head. I can't get past that. And two, from being a person that's brought up by a Macedonian immigrant, a Muslim immigrant, today married to a Jewish girl, my father met my mother in Espresso. It was a coffee bar that was near an airport station. And he was a dishwasher and she was a cashier. So they kind of struggled their way through life. And this guy just squanders everything. You know, he got handed down everything and he just lives in his head with all his money and squanders everything away. So those are the reasons why I just couldn't do it.
And you tried.
But I like the fact that around Copenhagen, I know where he used to live. I know these things. You have read a little bit, you know. I live on Gråbrødretorv today and he lived right around the corner. I like that. You know, I like the
why?
Fact. I like that we're both Copenhageners, you know, and I have an affinity and a love for this little city, just like it seemed that he had as well. You know, basically the city was his life.
And you mentioned in that piece that you forgot you wrote, but which it was very wonderful to find, that you in those gardens you love the silence, and Kierkegaard had a lot to say about silence. It's something that you seek also.
Oh yeah, I mean, our kitchen is anything but silence, and it's got nothing to do with screaming or shouting, but it's a vibrant place. We have 50 people cooking for 40. 24 nationalities trying to
get along
and make each other understandable, and It's and some t- and at the same time you have all these expectations when people come to our tables. So sometimes you just need to unwind, you know. And my everyday life is waking up, cooking porridge, and then you cook the lunchbox, and then I go to work, and then I cook, and then I come home very late, and I sleep a few hours. So those moments of silence is the perfect thing. I forgot to mention one thing about Kierkegaard, which I also really like about him.
Slowly but surely.
Yeah.
This may be an important moment.
It's very important.
It may be a moment of, you may actually all here be witnessing
you can
the
all
transformation of René Redzepi into a Kierkegaard reader. I just would like it may happen in front of your eyes.
Yeah, not that.
It might be good for you, a bit of,
I'm sure. But
anyway,
right now there is this wonderful thing called ramps, or in Danish it's called ramsløg. Yeah. And where Kierkegaard happens to be buried, for some strange reason, believe it or not, the best ramps in all of Denmark grows.
And just tell
so
me what is
you,
the
I have literally perhaps potentially consumed some of Kierkegaard. And this is also one of the differences between living in your head and sort of taking in the world. You know, I with food and the exploration of that, it's the one area where you actually consume the world. I mean, it's quite literally, and it's an old idea. This you are what you eat, but you literally are eating the world, and it becomes you. And I like that, and I like the fact that I can go to Assistentens Kirkegård, and I can pick the ramsløg right there, fertilized by dead people, and they taste delicious.
So we were talking in an earlier conversation of the ears of Kierkegaard, and this is another form of inheritance.
Do you think he would be happy for that?
I think it must be quite magnificent to think that your remains are somebody else's pleasure. And if you believe that, no. But anyway, no. What is a ramsinnen?
It's in French, it's la désousse. It's a leaf that looks like a tulip, but it tastes like a mixture.
Yeah, what does it taste like?
It tastes like a mixture. It's the most magical plant for us, the cooks around Copenhagen, around Denmark, really. Because, sure enough, the New Year's starts on the 1st of January. But for a cook, for me, the New Year starts when the ramp starts to shoot. That is the certain sign that winter is leaving us. And now the world will again begin to sprout, and everything will turn from pale gray to bright green. And it is just magical. It's a day of cheer when this little leaf finally arrives into the kitchen.
And so this leaf... what does it? It tastes like.
So it looks like a tulip leaf, and
this is on Kierkegaard's tomb.
Well, it's everywhere right now. There, not on the actual tomb, but it's nearby.
So do you go there and
yes,
and pick up
yes, those and off, and believe it or not,
a lot
in the
of
past, in the past 5 years, more often than so. We have to go early because other cooks are there also. Yeah.
They all have the Kierkegaard Ramsebag.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if they. I think people there. They, you know, they just go to grab the ramsons. But no, it's literally become this sort of symbol, at least for cooks, and you can even find it today in supermarkets. The sort of the perfect moment where the world again begins. You know?
Let's talk a little bit more about this notion of living too much in one's head.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel you live too little in your head?
Well, let me go into my head a little for 2 minutes.
Take your time.
Well, I think that there needs to be balance. And sure enough, maybe sometimes I could live a little bit more in my head. But I
want to make your life a little bit easier. Maybe you live in your head, but in a different kind of head than the...
It's much more spontaneous. It's much more in the moment. It's much more day by day. You know, you sort of make assessment of the world from the day you're in, and you don't look ahead too much because you can't. Everything that we do is more or less dictated by weather conditions. And if it rains one day, well, the next day the strawberries are shit, basically. So it's much more spontaneous and built on intuition, everything that we do. You come to work and you let your senses guide you somehow. And also, when you are a cook, ingredients come and disappear. If you reflect too long on it, the moment is gone. It's just...
Well, this is interesting. Now, we were talking earlier about choice. Mm-hmm. Your life is made of capturing the moment. Mm-hmm. And if you don't, it's gone.
It's gone.
It's gone. And what is gone? In your case, a new invention is gone.
A new invention or the moment, the perfect ingredient, the perfect flavor, the perfect mouthful, that moment of deliciousness that will make everybody so happy.
That moment of deliciousness.
Yeah, that would make everybody so happy. So, you know, I mean, I think one of the things that also irritated me about Kierkegaard always is that he seemed to be a little bit afraid to me. And
of what?
Just everything. Just if you think too much to me, you seem a little too afraid. And what we do is not being afraid. It's making decisions and acting on it all the time, like in the moment, constantly, all the time, all the time, all the time. So, and that's also another part of it, you know, that it's built. What we do is built on risk taking, on being unafraid.
You know, reading about you and knowing you a little bit as I do, it doesn't seem to me that you are afraid of learning about something new and reading.
No.
Before you became the foraging expert you are now in the world and created movements around the world to go back to nature in that particular way, you spent months reading Scandinavian, Swedish military books on on plants.
Yeah.
So there is a little bit of a scholar in you. Even though you stopped,
very little.
Very little.
Very little.
You stopped school at 15.
I was thrown out of school.
I know. We share that, by the way. I went to many different schools, so many that my parents got worried that there were no more schools for me to go to. But I did end in the end. I don't know how that happened, but it was said of you that you were ineligible to continue working and reading in an academic setting, and yet you spent months of your life learning about plants.
Yeah, well, I mean, I do read quite a bit, but only because I believe that that we are, what we do at the restaurant is we're trying to be creative, we're trying to understand, make sense of the place we're in a delicious sense. Sort of distilling.
The place is delicious, if you know it.
If you know it, exactly. So, because of that, and because we try to do it in a way that doesn't always look to the past, but looks towards the future, I believe that if you want to explore creativity in that sense, well, creativity occurs when you're able to take your past, whether from reading, conversations, interacting with other people, and bring that into the present by using your intuition. That's when new things happen. So for that reason, I read, but not because I'm interested in reading or I have an urge to do it. I do it because because my restaurant needs me to do it. You understand?
Absolutely, absolutely. I was trying to make the conversion happen here on stage. That you know, I might put the bug of Kierkegaard in you, and after this conversation here, you will all of a sudden find
it's
yourself.
I have to admit, it's already started a little bit.
A little bit?
Yeah, it has. I mean, it's.
I told you there would be confession, and here it is.
Yeah.
It started a little bit, and I. But you know, the truth is, he is so difficult.
Mm.
So we have to find points of entry, and I'll read.
I mean, it's very difficult.
Very difficult. I'll read a quotation to you on on silence, mm-hmm. and see how you respond, because you like that silence. Of the garden. Kierkegaard on solitude and silence and sickness unto death. Also, one must say some of his titles are not immediately appealing.
It's not a...
Yeah, I mean, Journal of the Seducer, yes. On the beach with a good photograph, yes. But sickness unto death isn't immediately what you would necessarily pick up instantaneously. On the other hand, he often feels a need of solitude and silence, which for him is a vital necessity, sometimes like breathing, at other times like sleeping. The fact that he feels this vital necessity more than other men is also a sign that he has a deeper nature. Generally, the need of solitude is a sign that there is spirit in man after all, and it is a measure for what spirit is. The purely dawdling inhuman and too human men are to such a degree without feeling for the need of solitude that, like a certain species of social birds, the so-called lovebirds, they promptly die if for an instant they have to be alone. In the constant sociability of our age, people shudder at solitude, to such a degree that they know no other use to put it to but, oh admirable epigram, as a punishment for criminals. But after all, it is a fact that in our age it is a crime to have spirit, so it is natural that people, the lovers of solitude, are included in the same class with criminals. I wonder if that speaks to you.
I mean, see, this is where it becomes too extreme for me, you know?
Say something about that.
Well, I mean, it's just, it's hard. It's hardcore. And to tell the truth, I mean, you sit down and you open this. Why do you read such a thing?
It's a good question.
I mean, it's to a good say question. That you have done it, or it, I mean...
No, it's a good question. It's a good question. No, but it is a good question, and it has to do something with posturing. It has something to do with what gives you pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
This does not give you pleasure.
No.
No. This is clear.
Yeah, I mean...
What gives you pleasure is an aesthetical quality that Kierkegaard actually does talk about, which is the pleasure of the senses,
mm-hmm.
the pleasure of deliciousness, the pleasure of immediacy. What Kierkegaard here is doing is saying to you, you know, the pleasure you feel of immediacy and deliciousness, wait a minute. Wait a minute, maybe also what you need to do is go inside and know what it means to be alone, and what it means to be alone in your conscience, and what it means to be alone in the company of those who are not well, of those who are dying, of those who are in utter solitude. All of, and so reading becomes this process whereby which you learn about those issues that maybe you don't think about in the same way when you're out picking those herbs near Kierkegaard's tomb. I don't know.
Maybe. Maybe. I'm not too sure. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's like I said, I have a hard time with it. I've tried. It's not. I haven't only tried here for this. I've also tried before. And I mean, I can't get past the fact that it's, it feels like a chore when hearing these things, you know. I have a lot of chore in my daily life that I learn from doing chores, not about reading about things about it.
Talk to me a little bit about, we'll get back to Kierkegaard, I promise, but I don't want to, for this to seem like a burden. I'll come back to the burden in a moment, but before I do, let's talk a little bit about the chores you do, which actually are not really only chores, but they give you great pleasure, which is to serve 40 tables a day. Eleven tables, 40 guests a day, and in some way surprise them. I mean, I think one of the pleasures of eating at your table is that you invite people to just say,
if they
to
do that.
Yeah, if they in a sense, I'm trying to make the parallel here desperately. If you allow yourself to enter into this world, I think something will happen to you, René.
Yeah.
But you ask your guests to have a leap of faith, to say, this is part of what grows near in Amo or wherever it is. I mean, I remember picking with you, you asked me to do something, which I now know you ask a few people to do who work in your kitchen. You asked me to get on my knees because you felt that if I got on my knees, you say this, it's a big, and Jane Cramer quotes this in her piece in The New Yorker, it's a beginning of faith. Right, it's a beginning of believing. If you get me on my knees and get me to, which I thought was a fantastically religious way of expressing it. If I'm on my knees, I'm sorry to be kneeling in front of you, but Jews very rarely kneel, so this is a very strange thing that I'm doing. If I pick this up, then something might happen. And I remember what you asked me to pick up, you asked me to pick up many things and didn't really comment on it, but it was. And I loved it. And you said, you know.
But that, to me, is also the difference between living in your head and not. So you can read about this thing, and then you can go out and taste it.
Right.
And know where it is, and follow its growth, and have a connection and an intimacy with.
But it does go through your head in some way. I mean, there is a connection. I mean, it's just the senses. You know, it's interesting because philosophers are not particularly sensualists often. I'm sure Pascal can correct me about this, but as I recall, Kant, in his Letters on the Sublime, says that the only reason that human beings have noses is that so that they can, and the sense of smell is so that they can tell what is foul meat.
Yeah.
You know, we've grown from being a
cat. That's a horrible thing. I mean, I totally don't understand that point of view.
Neither do I.
That food is only sustenance. And that's to me, it's just total bullshit. I mean, sure enough, great flavors, a well-cooked meal, gathering at the table, all these old-fashioned ideals of the perfect life, they won't make you survive, you know, in that sense. Your body doesn't need it to stay alive, but in my world, my mind does.
Well, you see,
it's the extra icing on top. This is what makes life fun to live. You know, we don't need it, but we have to embrace it. And there is a problem there with food and pleasure. Maybe, I don't know, maybe it's only in our part of the world. Maybe it's only in here, in cold, gray, Protestant North, that we have these...
Continue. This sort is of good. Cold, gray, North,
the Babette's Feast Syndrome. Yeah.
Babette's Feast Syndrome.
Syndrome, yeah. This sort of always complete fight against allowing yourself to explore pleasure through a delicious mouthful. That is something that's quite filled with conflict here. And I don't get that. You know, I don't get that. To me, that's one of the things that makes life fun.
Well, you see, in this way, you are enunciating to some extent, though it's limiting in Kierkegaard's worldview, the aesthete's point of view of pleasure. I'd like us to look at a clip quickly, if we could, of the end of Don Giovanni. As you all could tell, I was trying to sit down earlier, but René wanted to see the whole scene.
Yeah.
Give me your reactions. I mean, it obviously spoke to you in some way.
Well, he went off with a nice meal. I could see that much. It was a wonderful table. It was dressed with food, and you know, so in that sense, he must have had a lovely last meal. But at the same time, also, for some strange reason, I'm the sort of the advocate for the meal here. Why does the meal have to be put into this situation, this crazy evil man? And he's sitting there, and the last thing he does before he burns up is that he indulges into a classic bourgeois deed, is to eat a lot of food, you know? I don't know. I think, to me, the meal represents so much more than that. If the meal is involved, well, it should be in a happy ending.
Right. What does it involve?
Well, to me, food is everything.
It's the lens through which you see life.
If food is a metaphor for everything. It's a metaphor for how we interact with the world, on happy moments, on sad moments. I mean, you eat food, and food becomes who you are. It's a time machine, yeah. Food. It fills you with memories, you know. And I mean, I fell in love with cooking not because of, you know, 85-hour work weeks or
quite the contrary,
all the
yeah.
the cuts I have on my hand, or even the 2 centimeters. I lost courtesy of a sharp Japanese knife. I fell in love with deliciousness, flavor, what it does to you. To me, that is what makes life fun. One of the things that makes life fun is the difference between bodily maintenance and real living, you know, accepting deliciousness, flavor, the meal.
And, you know, we also talk about food for thought, things that inspire us to think, that are also nourishment.
Mm-hmm. Well, there you go. Even their food is
important.
Yeah.
Essential.
Mm-hmm. I think so. And you know, I mean, sure enough, like I just said before, we don't need all these things to stay alive. But we don't need to sit on this chair either. You don't need to have a comfortable stool. But it makes things more easy and more fun, you know? And I think we need to celebrate that a bit more. And maybe that's also one of the reasons why I just thought of that now. Maybe that's also one of the reasons why I never really went into Kierkegaard in the way, is because he's trained as a, or he went to school as a religious man, you know? Even though I understand there was lots of conflicts, but in the type of religion that we practice here, enjoying food, celebrating flavors, is almost as sinful as masturbating. You know, I mean, yeah, sure, things have changed. Yeah, yeah. but so there's always this conflict with it. Once I started reading that, he was a man that read about God in the church. Instantly, I know there's going to be filled with so much conflict that I maybe don't even bear to go through having again to sort of make reason for why I do what I do, besides, you know, operating a business.
Do you think that people come sometimes to your restaurant resistant?
Mm. Yeah. Are you kidding me?
No, I'm not. Tell me. No, because I'm thinking about the other side. You know that in a way, pleasure and seriousness don't go well together.
No, and also food is one of those things. It's just one of those things.
So people resist, and maybe your restaurant then can become a form of conversion, of changing people's mind.
Maybe. A lot we do, but there's several that we don't. I mean, food is a funny thing. I see it all the time, every day I go to work. And you can have the most adventurous people. I've seen it with some of the world's most avant-garde artists that, you know, experiment with their body and their mind. But when it comes to food, they want to eat the same 10 thing that they've been eating all their life. Full stop, huh? And so suddenly, like we have on the menu currently, there's a paste of wood ants with blueberry preserves and fresh goat milk curd. Now, I mean, the likelihood of you of tasting that before is like 1-2. You'd be struck by lightning, I would guess.
First,
before tasting.
I hope I will be struck by lightning after. I want to taste.
No,
that
so
first.
So
yeah.
so that, and people have all these animosities towards it already as they enter the restaurant, because they have these very set ideals about what flavor is, what it does to you, and what they need from it. And there's nothing. It's a very difficult thing to nudge.
And you know, I think coming back to Kierkegaard for a moment before we close, one of the extraordinary things about reading him, as I know you will, is that he also surprises us. I mean, it's other flavors, other tastes. As you heard earlier in conversations we had, he will say one thing and another, mm-hmm. and you will always be on your qui vive. You'll be surprised by what he says. You say, foraging is a treasure hunt. You have to believe the treasure is there. Mm-hmm. So it's also a strong belief system. You have to really let yourself believe that you will, in fact, discover something that you... I mean, I remember on our hunt, I tasted wild horseradish. I actually had no idea what I was tasting until you gave me words for it, mm-hmm. which is interesting. Is that there's so many things around us, we don't know what they are until we can put a word to them.
Sure.
And even when we do, it doesn't quite taste like what we imagine.
No, and that, to me, is one of the magical things with cooking and with what we do. And literally, I've seen it time and time again, and I saw it in you as well. We went to this shitty beach on Ama. And it is a horrible beach if you look. If your ideal of a beach is the Maldives, well, then this is not a very good beach because there's rotten seaweed everywhere.
You didn't mention that.
Well, you saw it.
Yes.
And out of this rotten seaweed sprouts all sorts of flavors, deliciousness. And I remember one specific moment where that changed me completely. That was sort of the seed for these 10 years. And this was on a cold spring day in, it's probably 2004. And I was up by Odsherred, it's called. And we were there on a beach, and it was with our waders on, and we're walking through this seemingly rotten seaweed. And it made these toilet plunger sound as we walked through. It's quite horrible, nasty flies biting everywhere. And suddenly there was this patch of green. And at that point, we had already been out in nature quite a bit. And you learn somehow to distinguish what's edible and what's not. You can somehow see, this is for the other mammals, this is for our type of mammals, you know. So there was this plush patch of green amidst all these rottening seaweeds and flies, and I went over there, and it was thick as a chive. and it looked like chives actually, and I snapped it, and it made the same sound like when you cut a knife through a watermelon, you know, crack, and I bite into it, and it, in my head, the sounds in my head was when you eat through an asparagus, you know, crunchy, delicious, and the juices bursted out in my mouth. First there was saltiness from the seaweeds, and then the flavor came. It was coriander, cilantro. This flavor that to me forever had been Thai food, or going to Mexico in ceviches, suddenly it was there, hidden in seaweed, disguised as grasses from a beach. And that to me opened the world to me. That was like, wow, you know, because the possibilities, I understand that, because we said to ourselves, only have one possibility, which is let's explore a larder, one door to open. I never expected there would be doors like that, coriander, or ants that taste like lemongrass, you know? So
it's interesting, you are coming to Kierkegaardian notions. Possibility, yeah. Slowly we're going in the right direction.
Yeah. I don't know what you're doing to me.
I don't know what I'm doing. Well, I've done it to a few others, but I want to finish with a quotation, but before I do, and maybe have you say something about it, but before I do, I mean, it's you know, this has been, how should I say, thanks to the Royal Library here and to Lise Bach Hansen and to all of you kind people for inviting me to your magnificent city. This has been an experiment. It's also been an experiment in trying not to be pompous about a great Dane, a great philosopher, someone who probably is so recalcitrant, a word I love, which literally means kicking back, someone who you would have trouble meeting and trouble reading, and an invitation, a very strong invitation, to dip your toe into Kierkegaard. Try a bit. Some of you may read a lot. Some of you in this audience are probably great experts of Kierkegaard. But for those of you who have never read Kierkegaard, that's okay. It's okay. You have time. He is one of the possibilities, and he is someone whose life, whose work your life will change. And on this note, I want to read something of his that I very much like. He says, "What is a poet? An unhappy man who hides deep anguish in his heart, but whose lips are so formed that when they sigh, a cry passes through them. It sounds like lovely music. And people flock around the poet and say, 'Sing again soon. May new suffering torment your soul, but your lips be fashioned as before, for the cry would only frighten us, but the music that is blissful.'"
I am ready for lots of suffering.
And some bliss too. Mm-hmm. René, it's been a pleasure speaking with you.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much.